Amen. Let's stand up and worship this morning. You know, some weeks it's and they fled to the Lord for refuge. This week it's school's out for the summer. And the other one is they fled to Florida for refuge. I think everybody's palm trees and umbrella drinks this week. But we're going to enjoy the presence of the Lord. I read to the team earlier, you know, the Lord sends you what you need exactly when you need it. Amen? That's the reason there's no reason to fret or worry, because that which you need, He has knowledge of that you need it before you ask. That's what the scripture says. He wants you to ask, but He has knowledge of what you need. And yesterday evening, I was talking to Tiffany. I said, we got to have a nap sometime, a break, you know, a little bit of rest. I said, you can't go 14 weeks without a day off. You got to, at some point, you just got to sit down, whether the work's done or not. And literally, I was thinking, after church Sunday, I'm going to sleep. Like, I'd done skipped church last night. Amen. Yeah, and I was in the recliner. My wife, actually, she said, when's this basketball going to be over? You're watching last night. And I'm like, yes, I don't know. So I get an email last night from Desiring God. If you don't subscribe to it, John Piper, Bethlehem Baptist Church in Minnesota. And he was talking about the glory of Sunday, that we get numb to what God's doing in our midst every Sunday. Yeah, and we almost just try to, in routine, skip over it to the next thing. I need my nap. I got to go to work. My kids got. And Monday takes away from Sunday. Sunday evening takes away from Sunday. And in the article, the writer said, this is as close as you get to heaven every week. This is more like heaven, this body of believers worshiping together and glorifying God is the closest you will ever get to heaven this side of eternity. This looks more like heaven. This will feel more like heaven. So he was saying, don't skip the thing that looks most like the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven, to get back to work, the preacher's looking for his recliner. Don't skip this moment. So today I just encourage you, no matter what you got going this evening or Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, whatever that looks like for you, just be present right now. Amen. Let's just all be present and aware and allow the Holy Spirit to do something great in the midst of His people. Father, in Jesus' name, thank You that today we can come in and worship You. And God, not take it for granted, not think, well, it'll always be there, or God, that this is something that we have to do. But God, I pray You just renew that spirit in all of us of the pleasure of worshiping together, the pleasure of worshiping You, the pleasure of today together in unity, knowing that You are going to do something great when the people pray, when the people sing, when the word is expounded upon and people respond, God, that You are going to honor these things and You're going to honor this gathering, God, today. I know You are, Lord, because You said You would. Bless this time. Bless this place. Let us truly reach out to You, and may we be touched by Your Holy Spirit, God. There's nothing we can do here unless, Lord, You do great things. You are the one that has to save us and change us. We put our lives fully in Your hands right now, trusting You in all things as we worship You. We love You, Jesus. In Your name we pray. Amen.
Tell him you love him.
I love the King and the King loves me. I love the King and the King loves me. I love the King and I know that He loves me.
Sing it to the Lord.
I love the King and the King loves me. I love the King and the King loves me. I love the King and I know that He loves me. I love the King and the King loves me. I love the King and the King loves me. I love the King and I'm sure that He loves me. Lord, here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that You're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Light of the world, You step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see. Beauty that makes this heart adore You. Hope of a life spent with You. And here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that You're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. King of all days, oh so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly You came to the earth You created, all for love's sake became poor. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that You're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. Lord, I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. Lord, I'll bow down. Here I am to say that You're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Here I am to
bow down.
Here I am to bow
down.
Here I am to say that You're my God. You're altogether
lovely,
altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
Amen. Give the Lord some praise. Amen. The goodness of God. That's what got us to this place today. this hour, this moment. I hope we don't ever take for granted how we got to where we're at and what God's done. And I'm not even talking about in the life of our church, but when you sing this song, this is talking about your life, thinking about from birth till now, how good God's been and what He's done to preserve you and protect you and what He's let you go through, but He ended up bringing you out for your good and His glory. All your life, if you'll open your spiritual eyes, you'll see all your life that God's hand, even as a lost man or woman, God's hand was there doing things in you, for you, through you. God has been moving in your life, all of your life, and that's been something that we need to think about for a long time, and that would cause us to worship Him. Even when you were a God hater, He was a Matt lover. Amen. Even when we were distanced from Him, living any way we could, God still, that's why I love Romans chapter 5, verse 8. But God, you know, when we were out in sin, yet while we were still in sin, God chose to give His Son for us. So as you sing this morning, I heard a guy say the other day, if your eyes leak, your head won't swell. You know, some of y'all could use some eye leakage. And figure out you didn't get here on your own. You ain't get here. No such thing as a self-made man or a self-made woman. We're all made by God and furthered by Him too. So as Miss Linda sings this, may it move you to understand what He's done in your life.
Never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Good Father. Amen. Thankful for everyday life, but there had to be that moment in your life that you come to the knowledge, the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. There was a time where you came to that place where God in Himself came to you through the Holy Spirit and helped you understand that you needed Him more than you needed anything else. And I don't know if you've been there this morning, but that's what we called about getting saved. Somebody said, what am I getting saved from? Getting saved from your sin. I mean, you owe a sin debt that you cannot pay. And Jesus Christ is paying that debt for you. He didn't owe it, but He loved you enough to pay that debt for you, to come to earth to suffer. That way you wouldn't have to. See, what I like about getting saved is we are completely away from the wrath of God. Amen? I'll not ever experience the wrath of God because I am a child. And He's not going to pour His wrath out on me. In fact, He's going to get me out of here. He's got a place prepared for me. He's got more than I can understand or I've ever been into. He completely knows exactly where I'm at, and He's blessing me all the way through. He's working in my life to do of His good will and pleasure. So this morning, I'm encouraging somebody, if you're not saved, if you're not given to Christ, if your heart is not His, if God is not your Father, then get saved. And if you are saved, sing this song. Sing the song. Look, this is not song on a piece of paper with words and Christmas singing. This is the song of our heart. This is the life change that God has done that causes us to praise Him. I don't want anybody just to sing today. I want you to be moved in your heart that God might do something great in your heart and life.
A river of gladness that pours from Emmanuel's veins. The sinner was plunged beneath the flood and God saved. Since then I walked in forgiveness. All of my guilt was erased. Chains of the past were broken at last. I got saved. Oh, I got saved. I'm undone by the mercies of Jesus. I'm undone by the goodness of the Lord. I'm restored and made right. He got a hold of my life. I got Jesus. How could I want more? I've received nothing but goodness. I've tasted and tasted your grace. I was so lost till I fell at the cross and God saved. I got saved. I'm undone by the mercies of Jesus. I'm undone by the goodness of the Lord. I want more. The love of God gave me His pardon. The love of God won't let me stay the same. The love of God calls me up. Jesus. I'm undone by the goodness of the Lord. I'm restored and made right. He got a hold of my life. I got Jesus. How could I want more? I'm undone by the mercy.
Jesus, thank you for your blessings of a son that came to earth so we could meet the Father. And may that continue to happen in this place. And even the people who are saved, God, may we continue to grow closer to that Father who has made all provision for our salvation. Thank you for saving us. Thank you for changing us. And may we celebrate you today in what you've done. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Shake hands with someone. And worship the Lord this morning. Glad Jesus saved us today.
Then let's get started in Hebrews chapter 10. Father, in Jesus' name, thank you that young people, God, are just so precious in your sight. God, I thank you that they're made for you and by you. And God, that we are called to do good things with them. God, we are called to raise them, to point them in the right direction that they might be spiritually fit when they grow up. God, I pray in Jesus' name that today that process will begin in the heart of one that might get saved. Or might have questions, God, that we will be able to answer those questions and lead them down paths of righteousness for your name's sake. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. There was actually a CareNet conference in Dixon yesterday. CareNet is like a pro-life organization that is, unplanned pregnancies. Crisis Pregnancy Center. They had a conference in Dixon yesterday, and there was actually a group of protesters. They said they were Antifa. I don't know if you saw them on the news, but at the entrance of Montgomery Bell Park, actually protesting the CareNet conference yesterday. So life is not precious to everyone. It's not something that everyone understands that God fully has plans and purposes for every child, whether we planned them or not. Amen? God has plans and purposes for every child, whether we planned them or not. Hebrews chapter 10, while you're turning there, I want to tell you what I told the church Wednesday night. This is a praise the Lord moment. We're getting real close to getting our certificate of occupancy for our new building. Everything's coming down to the wire. We have some things we have to do as a church, and these things do require money and effort. So in the next 5 or so weeks, we are looking for $100,000 to finish what we are doing. Now you say, well, that's a huge number. It actually isn't. We've already raised $500,000 in this whole trip. And for a church that didn't have $600 in the bank and 40 people some 7 years ago, praise God, that's a big feat. Amen? So I want to praise the Lord for that. So we're here to just encourage you. If you haven't pledged, there's pledge cards in the back. If you're giving weekly, praise the Lord. Our weekly giving is great. We've averaged about $1,800 a week last month, which would have been $7,200, and that's way above our payment, and maybe even take care of electricity bills and all of that stuff, too. We've got that in the budget. But we just need a little boost here to get over the hump. And so I'm just putting that in your ear. Number one, I want you to pray. God has all the money in the world. Amen? That's not an issue for Him. The only issue is it's in people's pockets. We need to pray about that. We need to pray about where God's going to do His next miracle. He's done miracles after miracles. In fact, after I told them this Wednesday night, Thursday and Friday, we had some changes on our building we were trying to do and some things, and ended up getting $14,000 back towards our funds. So the night after we announced all this, God just started opening up the windows of heaven again. So be praying about what God's going to do. Be praying about what you're going to do. And I want, because here's what I want. Whether you're a widow and you've got three mites or you're a millionaire and got 3 million, I want us all to do our part. When we get in that building, I don't want anybody to say one person built it. I want it for the glory of the Lord, and I want everybody to say, and, you know, down the road, I'm going to tell my kids and my grandkids, look at what God did through faithful people. And I just wanted to relay that to you. It looks like a big hill, but we're already climbing it. And it's no big deal to the Lord. I'm looking forward to the day ahead when we get over there. And I'm probably going to preach about an hour and a half every Sunday over there, especially when it's one service for a few minutes, because I won't get to preach three times. And I'll feel like I'll go home and won't know what to do. I'll just have to run laps around the house because I won't be tired. So I'm gonna preach a little longer when we get over there. We're going to worship a little longer, preach a little longer. And if you don't like worship and preaching, well, you're just at the wrong place. I'm just Hebrews chapter 10. I titled this sermon Let Us because there's three let us phrases in Hebrews chapter 10, verses 23 through 25. He's encouraging his brother and sisters to go right into the presence of God last week with sincere hearts, thanking and fully trusting God. And now he's encouraging them to do something besides just trust him. Amen? I think it's where we might get hung up a little bit. I've trusted him. Now what? Today we're going to examine these statements that the Lord has for us. These aren't only for the Hebrew Christians. I think they are very relevant in our day and in the life of our church. Verses 23 through 25. Let us hold tightly without wavering to the hope we affirm, for God can be trusted to keep His promise. Verse 24. Let us think of good ways, or ways to motivate one another to acts of love and good works. Verse 25. And let us not neglect our meeting together, as some people do, but encourage one another, especially now that the day of His return is drawing near. Pray with me. Father, in Jesus' name, I pray that You would open up the Word of God by the power of the Holy Spirit, Lord. We've put our time in our study, God. We've done everything to be approved by You to speak these words this morning, God. And I'm praying, Lord, for a double portion of Your Spirit. Not just not just a hearing and a believing, but a doing, God, that this would carry on farther than just this place this morning, but everybody in this place would know, God, this is your will for them, God. I'm still praying that someone that's lost this morning would be saved. Let your anointing and your spirit be so strong that the lost person, God, could not help but fall at your feet, and we who are saved would do the same. God, we all need to be on that place, submitting ourselves to the will of God the Father. Thank you, Father, for the Son, and thank you, Son, for answering these prayers. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Since Jesus died for you, since Jesus has made a new way, since we have a great high priest, since you are fully trusting him, since you have been made clean, number one, let us hold tightly without wavering to the hope we affirm, for God can be trusted to keep his promise. He is encouraging them since all of these things. He has walked us through chapter number 10 up to chapter number 10. He's told us about the sacrificial systems. He's told us about the blood of bulls and goats. He's told us about all the things in the temple and the things that they were doing and trying to show them the difference between their ritual and what was now relationship with Jesus Christ. Now that he's pushed them to fully trust him, saying, look, get away from the eating certain things. Get away from the having to pray this many times a day. Prayer's good, but it's not this time. It's not a ritual anymore. Get away from having to go to this place at this time and all these things. Get away from that and understand Christ can be trusted. And if you're going to trust him, then you need to hold fast, and other versions say this, to the profession of your faith. Hold tightly to that which God has done in you, to keep in mind, to possess, to retain. So he didn't want them to go back to the law. He didn't want them to go back to their old ways. He didn't want them to without wavering. Is that better? To the hope. I thought I was just real loud and they'd turn me down. You know, I just thought, oh, golly, you know. Without wavering to the hope we affirm to. If you want to be settled in who you are and who He is and what you believe, there's no room for back and forth in the kingdom of God. I talked to the men out of James chapter number 1 Thursday night. And I talked about a divided loyalty. I talked about how God's going to put pressure in your life. And He's going to push you. And He's going to test your faith. And the reason He's doing this is because He wants you to be stable in your Christianity. He wants you to be the same person all the time. He wants you to be consistent. Now, you're not going to be perfect, but if 90% of the time you can do what you need to do and 10% of the time you can fall towards God and not back away from Him, you'll be in pretty good shape. So He's pushing them in this place, trust God, grab on to Jesus, get some stability in your life, do not be tossed around, make sure you're holding on to the right person. Grab a hold of that which has grabbed a hold of you. God is going to do our part, His part. He's always going to do His part. This is our part, to latch on to Him, to draw close to God, to hold firmly to God's unchanging hand. He said, hold tightly without wavering to the hope you affirm. Number 2, in verse 24, He says this, let us think of good ways to motivate one another to acts of love and good works. I said good ways. You know why I said that? Because there's bad ways of motivation. You ain't never done nothing right in your life. Does that sound like good motivation? You know, a lot of times I think we try to motivate with criticism. And we call it constructive. You know, can I give you some constructive criticism? Don't you just criticize me. Won't you just say it? I mean, you're just flowering it up. You're trying to tell me what I'm doing. And that's good. I'm good for that. But in the church, listen to me. The whole world is trying to beat you down. I mean, the whole world itself. And when I talk about the world, I mean the sinful world. There's people yesterday that were trying to save lives of babies at a CareNet conference doing the work of the Lord, which is pro-life, and there's a literal group of masked people at the entrance of the park trying to destroy what they're doing. Like, all around you is trouble. All around you is criticism. All around you is pessimism. Is that how you say it? Yeah. All around you is the glass half empty. And look, I'm not saying there's not going to be times where there is correction and there is things that we need to say or do to get people back into their right place. But the first thing He encourages these people to do after they settle their faith in Jesus is to think of ways to motivate one another to acts of love and good works. Let's motivate each other. I know I'm saved. I know God's in me. I know I have the Holy Spirit. I am fully trusting Him. I'm holding tightly to Jesus. Now, let's do something. Let's do something for the glory of God. And let's do it together. I mean, this constitutes a togetherness where we as the church, that's why I'm saying this meeting is so important. These things that we do as a group are so important. Let's motivate. Once you get saved, it's time to serve. How are we going to act? How are we going to motivate people to act? And acts of love and good works. After you are getting saved and God's worked in your life, motivate means to sharpen alongside of something. You know, you need to be a self-motivator in life. Amen. Anybody need some help with self-motivation? Yeah, every morning. Oh. But at some point, I've got to figure out the value of each other. And I've got to come along, Ken, and while we're rubbing shoulders, we're sharpening each other. And Ken's not coming in every Sunday going, well, we need to do this, and we need to do that, and this ain't right, and we need to. Ken's coming in and saying, man, did you have a good week? Man, how was it? Is there anything I can look? I'm not making this up. This is what Ken does. He comes in. Did you have a good week? Yeah. Is there anything we can do for you? That you need anything? Like literally, he is pouring into me. I'm probably pouring less into him. I'm like, Ken, you need to, like this from the pulpit. But he is motivating me and pushing me to do what God wants me to do in my life. Once you get saved, you got the inside right. Now the inside needs to come out on the outside, and you need to do something with your life besides doing something for yourself. It's time to love God and love others. It's time to serve God and serve others. I like that word, acts of love. I'm not trying to get you to do something that is not in your nature or your DNA. This is things that have been implanted in you by the Holy Spirit. And I'm trying to motivate you to act out of the love of Christ. This word love here is the agape love of Jesus, which is an unconditional, unwavering, always there, consistent and constant in the life of the people of God. It is something that we get to, and listen, we get to share with each other. We get to love on each other. We get to help each other. We get to encourage each other. We get to live life together. Everything around us is inciting us to do the opposite, to get upset and to get pessimistic and to get down on the church and to get down in life, and the world's going to end and all of these things. And that's real good. But until the time where God makes everything new, it's time for us to push each other to love people. Not just to say we love people, but to act with it. How am I going to do acts of love? How am I going to show it's not enough just to talk about the love of God? It is enough to save you, but after you're saved, you got to do something with what God has given you and push each other. Where? Listen to me. Who are you motivating right now in your Christian life to serve? And if you can't answer that question, are you really serving? So that's the way my mind works. When the scripture says something, I don't go, well, Corey could do a better job at this. I go, me. Who am I motivating? Well, you're the preacher, you motivate everybody. No, that's generic to me. Who am I personally motivating to do acts of love and service? And then if I am not myself motivating someone, am I really doing those things? Am I really serving God? Am I really loving people? Personally serving God by acts of love? And listen, here's the bottom line. If I'm not doing it personally, I'm not going to be real good motivation to somebody else. Well, Corey, you need to, and then I'm not doing it. How's that going to work? That's like you raising your kids and telling them they need to, and them seeing you do something the complete opposite. It never works. I'm telling you right now, it does not work. You first have to be motivated to be a motivator, and you have to do something in order to get some other people to do something. How are you serving widows? How are you serving orphans? People say, well, y'all are pro-life as long as they're in the womb, but you do nothing with them after they get out of it. Well, that's not exactly true. We have kids' homes. We have children's homes. We have orphanages. We have adult homes. The Tennessee Baptists and the Southern Baptists do a good job of doing these things. But I ask myself, how am I doing these things? How am I helping the helpless and the hopeless and the hungry and the destitute and the hurting and the poor, the starving? How am I personally acting in love towards somebody and doing something good for somebody besides myself? Coming to church, listen to me, I'm trying to stress this. Coming to church is not serving the Lord. It's just not. Service starts after this point. Now, there's some of us that serve in various capacities, but we just don't ever want to get to the point where we're checking the church box. We're checking the prayer box. We're checking the Bible reading box. Because that's what he's trying to get them. He has got them out of understanding this is ritual, this is relationship. if we're not careful in this journey, after finding relationship, at some point, we'll want to go back to ritual. Amen? Be habit forming. I'm just going to check my box. I'm going to check my box, and God's going to be happy with me. Now, actually, God's going to want to know what you're doing Monday. Why don't you check a box on Monday? You know, and listen, it's okay to have a list and mark things off. I'm going to witness to somebody today. And when you get that done, you're going to witness. I accomplished my goal. But we got to make sure these are real, living, live things, acts of service and acts of love. Now, I said coming to church is not serving the Lord. That's why I believe verse 25 is in there. Verse 25 in the third, let us, he says, is this. Let us not neglect our meeting together, as some people do, but encourage one another, especially now that we see the day of his return is near. There's a great danger in church being optional. You listening to me? There's a great danger in church being optional. I know people who have taken their children at an early age and gave them the option of going to church, and they are nowhere to be found right now, and their parents are still coming. Church is not optional. But let's do this. Let's take the word church off of it. Let's just say this. Gathering with believers is not optional. And however they gather, because people say, you just want people to come to church. Well, yeah, you're right. I'm not going to deny that. But this is how we do it. This is how we gather. It might not be how they did it in the first century, but this is how we do it in the 21st. And so since we've established guidelines and boundaries, and we're going to meet on the first day of the week on Sunday together to worship and serve and learn and do all of these things, then we, listen to me, if God is committed, and if your church, and this is your church, so I may be talking to someone in Facebook land, if your church gathers on Tuesdays and Thursdays, be faithful on Tuesdays and Thursdays. I mean, whatever you do, do it. He's saying to these people who just, and this is what I can't get it. People say, well, I can just be just as close to God out in the boat as I can in a church. I can be as close to God at this game or this thing. Or that. No. You can't. Because that boat ain't provoking you to acts of love and service. You can't. If you're not coming to the place, whatever that place is, regularly, to the place where God's people is, you are never going to be pushed past the place where you're comfortable. Because all that's going on with you in the boat is you talking to yourself, and you've already talked yourself out of church, and the boat's not going to talk you into it. Amen? Like, you got to understand that this is the place where iron sharpens iron. That's what we talked about. This is the place where we encourage one another. This is the place where we bear one another's burdens. This is the place where, listen, there's no other place that we gather on earth where we gather together to worship the Lord in spirit and in truth like they did in the early church. They came together to pray. They came together to sing. They came together to serve. They came together. In fact, you could, in the early church in the first century, you could not find the church when they weren't together. Because they always were. Some people were thinking, I think, that this was optional because they were still in ritual. I've got to go to the temple this day. I've got to pray at this time. I've got to sacrifice on this day. Days on the calendar. I got to check my box. The apostle's saying, why would you neglect this when we see the days coming, when we see that Jesus is going to return, when we see that people are falling off into hell, when we see that all these things are going on. I don't know about you, but the thing about the day that we live in is we're closer to the day of Christ's return than we have ever been. And we got to understand that the signs of the times are where they are because of where we are at in the last day. Paul told Timothy, perilous times shall come. People will be lovers of themselves instead of lovers of God. They will chase their flesh. They will fatten their pockets. They will only want to hear teachers that say what they want to hear. It's going to get worse, and it's going to get worse until the time of Jesus Christ's return. And what are we to be doing? We're to be going out into the world and serving, but we're also to be coming into a place, a safe place, a harbor, a hospital, while all the world's against you and the world's going to hell in a handbasket. You've got to come in here and get revived and remove some of that mess and get heaven to where it needs to be and the Holy Spirit to fall, and then go out into the world and be the good soldier God's called you to be. You've got to do it. You will never, hear me, you will never be what God's called you to be if you neglect the meeting together. In the end of this, he said, we're going to do it for encouragement. Encouragement. And I thought about that a little bit. What is the encouragement? Well, in their day, the encouragement was this, that it's not always going to be like this. Think about that. It's not always going to be like this. They were being destroyed. They were being persecuted. They were being killed. They were being suppressed. And they would come together and go, one day this is all going to be over. One day Jesus is coming back. Isn't that what he said? Now, these are first century Christians. And this is what I can't understand. First century Christians who've heard, some of them have heard Jesus speak. Some of them are speaking to people who have heard Jesus speak. And he's saying, meet, love, serve, encourage. Now, here's this. If it was that important, less than 100 years removed from the time of Christ's death, burial, and resurrection, how much more important is it over 2,000 years more removed? How much more encouragement do we need? Oh, they scoff at us. Church ain't cool. It ain't supposed to be cool. They scoff at us. They make fun of us. Oh, you've been saying for 2,000 years that Jesus you serve is coming back. Peter wrote about that also. He said this, they're making fun of us. But God is not slack concerning his promise. Or God is not slow concerning his promise, as some men count slowness. But is long-suffering to all of us, not willing that anybody should perish, but that all should come to repentance. The very ones that are making fun of us are the very reason he doesn't return. And you've got to keep encouraging yourself. How are you going to keep serving the Lord? How are you going to keep doing what you're going to do? How are you going to hold firmly? How are you going to grasp tightly? How are you going to put your hands to? That's the thing about this. Once you find faith, then put your hands to the plow and don't look back. How are you going to guarantee that you're going to plow straight the rest of your life? Well, you're going to do it by figuring out that we're going to have to lean on each other and help each other. I think about a thing in Scripture all the time, that when Christ returns, will he find you faithful? And I say to myself, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. I'm going to do everything in my ability, whether by rapture or by death, when I leave this place, that I've done a few things. I've held on tightly. I've served and loved the best that I could. With all that's within me, I served and I loved. And I didn't neglect his church. I love the church with all my heart. I love this building, but I love you more. And I love every Sunday that I can come together with like-minded people that love Jesus, that want to experience the Holy Ghost, and that say, I'm going to do this until His return. And God's going to find faith. If He don't find faith in nowhere else in this county, and look, there is more faithful people, but we can't worry about them. If He finds faith, let it be found here. Every head bowed and every eye closed. I want to encourage you today, if you've strayed away, or if you've just not been serving and loving, if you've thought church was optional, any of these things, I encourage you to come to the altar. Most of all, if you have not been saved by the glorious sacrifice of Jesus Christ right now, you need to commit your heart and life to
Him. The more I seek You, the more I find You, the more I find You, the more I love You. I wanna sit at Your feet, drink from the cup in Your hand, lay back against You and breathe, feel Your heartbeat. This love is so deep, it's more the more I find you, the more I find you, the more I love you. I wanna sit at your feet, drink from the cup in your hand, lay back against you and breathe, feel your heartbeat. This love is so deep, it's more than I can stand. I melt in your peace,
and welcome to Missionary Grove. We are so glad that you all chose to be here and to worship with us today. If you're a first-time visitor, please be sure to fill out the MGBC Connection Card, which is the tear-off section of your bulletin. Fill that information out and turn it into the Welcome Center, where we have a very special gift waiting for you. Missionary Grove is partnering with a rehabilitation facility called the Hope Center. We are raising the funds to begin an all-male center right here in Benton County. If you would like to give towards this ministry, you can do so by placing your envelope labeled the Hope Center in the offering plate, or you can give online at missionarygrove.com. If you have a prayer request that you would like to share amongst your church family or through the MGBC prayer chain, please see Miss Jackie Keniston. Or you can put your prayer request in our prayer box that we have located in the foyer area underneath the bulletin board. Fill that prayer request form out and be sure to select whether or not you want your prayer to be kept private or shared amongst the prayer chain. For more information, please see Miss Jackie Keniston. The Daughters of the King Ministry Group will be putting their hope into action. Thursday, May 30th at 5:30 p.m., they will be hosting Christ Cafe at the First United Methodist Church. We are in need of some awesome volunteers to help prepare and serve the meal. So if you are interested, please see the sign-up sheet that we have posted on the back bulletin. And for more information, please see Miss Christy Arnold. Our Happy Heart Senior Adult Group will be traveling to New Concord, Kentucky to have lunch at the Cypress Spring Resort Restaurant on Saturday, June 1st. All senior adults are invited to attend. Please see the sign-up sheet that we have posted on the back bulletin so reservations can be made. You all will meet here at Missionary Grove to carpool at 11 a.m. For more information, please see Ms. Greta Sewell. Our next Girls Night Out will be held on June 13th at 6:30 p.m. here in the Fellowship Hall. We will be having a square barn painting party hosted by Miss Cammie White. The cost will be $25 each, and be sure to sign up before June 5th. We are encouraging all ladies to attend. Bring a finger food and come on out for a great night of devotion and fellowship with your sisters in Christ. Thank you all again for being here with us at Missionary Grove today. We hope that you will join us again next week. Please remember to share hope through the love of Jesus. God.
Father, thank you for this time. For this love them. They love other. May they bless you.